Happy New Year, everybody. The brand new USDA Dietary Guidelines were just released, and this always generates a ton of controversy. I completely agree with some of the things they say, and I strongly disagree with others. For those of you not in the US, the USDA Guidelines are the official dietary recommendations for Americans. So let's take a look at what foods they recommend and what foods they don't, and what it means for us all. One thing they emphasize is the focus on dietary patterns. It's not about superfoods. No single food is gonna make or break your diet. It's about the general pattern. Do you eat an abundance and variety of fresh fruits and vegetables? Is a much more important question than whether you're eating kale or sesame seeds specifically. In fact, they present three healthy dietary patterns as an example: an omnivorous one, a Mediterranean, and a more vegetarian. They're not meant to cover every option, just to illustrate the flexibility that there's a lot of wiggle room within the principles of a healthy diet. Okay, so what are those principles? They list six food groups to focus on and four to limit. The six to favor are fruits and vegetables, not surprising, which they recommend should make up half of your plate. Here's how the average American eats compared to the recommendations, over or under the line. Fruit, almost 80% of Americans undereat fruit. Vegetables, almost 90% of people undereat them. Green vegetables, orange vegetables, legumes, starchy vegetables, you name it, all massively undereaten. Let's face it, the only vegetables Americans crush are potatoes and tomatoes. The next recommended food group are grains, where at least half are supposed to be whole grains. Now, that probably sounds surprising to a lot of you. Half of grains can be refined? And I agree, it sounds high, although it includes most breads, white rice, pasta, etc. The other thing to bear in mind is these guidelines aren't shooting for a picture-perfect diet. It's trying to be realistic for 330 million people who, in average, eat pretty horribly. Now, online, there's this whole current that Americans are fat and sick because the guidelines keep recommending grains. But the truth is, most people overeat refined grains, and whole grains are massively underconsumed. Almost no one reaches the recommendations. It's easier to find a unicorn than an American who eats enough whole grains. They spell it out very clearly. From the first edition of the guidelines 40 years ago, Americans have fallen far short of meeting recommendations. And diets high in red and processed meat, sugar, and refined grains, so basically the standard American diet, are associated with detrimental outcomes. I'm not exactly a fanboy of the USDA guidelines. As you'll see, I disagree with plenty. But Americans overeat junk. That's not exactly a newsflash. The truth is, if they followed the guidelines on grains, that would actually be a massive upgrade. Now, you might ask, if people just ignore them, then what's the point of the guidelines? And that's a fair question. But they do affect a lot of governmental programs like school lunches, and they are the reference for health professionals across the country. So they do carry a lot of weight. Okay, the next food group they recommend is dairy. And this is always very controversial, and Canada famously dropped the dairy in their last national guidelines and started telling people to drink mostly water. So this year, people asked me on social media if I thought the US was going to do the same. I was skeptical, and predictably, they didn't. My position is we should tell people the truth, explain the pros and cons, and let them decide. Now, one major issue around all discussions on dairy is the ethics of how the animals are treated and really disposed of in the dairy industry. And I completely agree it's a massive issue, and I think people should be shown how it's produced. But I also think we should tell people the nutritional facts objectively. A healthy dietary pattern can include some dairy or not. It's a choice. It depends on factors like lactose tolerance, the type, the amount, what else is eaten, etc. So, telling people that dairy is poison in any amount, for anyone, like we see online sometimes, doesn't really reflect the totality of the evidence. But neither is the other extreme of suggesting that dairy is essential and if you don't have any, you're in trouble. And these guidelines go too far in this second direction. They show dairy as a key food group, not as an option among others. They even state healthy dietary patterns feature dairy, not may feature dairy, which would be the accurate statement and would carry a very different connotation. Now, they do include soy milk in this dairy category, but not almond milk or rice milk, oat milk, all the other plant milks. But the truth is, none of those are necessary. Cow milk, soy milk, almond milk, they're all optional. And I went on their website and did the quick diagnostic quiz. I entered what I normally eat, and the feedback was that I'm doing great on the vegetables and the grains, but I need some help with the dairy. I guess consuming zero dairy is not enough for them. So this is very misleading. And the quiz specifically asks about greens, which I eat daily, but then ignores those sources of calcium. So this is one of my main problems with these guidelines, this unscientific pushing of dairy as a need, not an option. And I completely understand we can't just tell 300 million people to drop dairy overnight, because if they don't replace it with other sources of calcium and vitamin D, etc., they'll run into problems. But that's a reason to inform people of their choices, not to imply that this is an essential food. It's just not scientific. Okay, moving on. The next recommended group is protein foods, which some people don't like because protein is a nutrient, not a food group. But I get what they're saying, food's more concentrated in protein. Now, look at the contrast between this section and dairy. They list animal and plant sources of protein. They explain a dietary pattern can exclude meats if people choose. They even say eating seafood or beans, peas, and lentils more often could help meet recommendations while still ensuring adequate protein. It's a very different tone from the dairy section. Now, it's well known and understood that the USDA has an inherent conflict of interests. They advise the population on healthy eating, but at the same time, they have to protect agricultural interests. Marion Nestle explains this really well in Food Politics, which is a great book I recommend to anyone who's interested in knowing more about this. 100 years ago, the main causes of death were infectious diseases, and nutrient deficiencies were common. So telling people to just eat more of everything was great for health and great for agriculture. There was no contradiction. But then we beat a lot of the infectious illnesses. And nowadays, most of the diseases in the West are tied to overconsumption of some foods. So suddenly, the USDA was stuck. Telling people to eat less of some foods makes sense scientifically, but it hurts agriculture. I mean, it's in the name. The USDA is the Department of Agriculture. So if they prioritize agriculture, that's not exactly a huge surprise. The only solution long-term is for dietary guidelines to be issued by a different organization that only cares about the science, like the Institute of Medicine, for example. It's the only way forward. And finally, the last recommended group is oils, which what they really mean is unsaturated fat. They include nuts and seeds and seafood and avocado in that group. Now, the four foods of concern that they advise limiting: added sugars, keeping them under 10% of calories, and even less for small children. Saturated fat, also under 10% of calories, and favoring unsaturated, especially polyunsaturated fats instead. Completely agree, we went over the evidence very recently. Sodium, ideally under 2300 milligrams a day. And finally, alcohol, under 2 drinks a day for men, 1 for women. There was controversy over sugar and alcohol that maybe limits should be even lower, and I think it's a reasonable argument. Now, one thing the guidelines innovated on: they issued recommendations for small children. Here's the gist. During the first 6 months, they recommend breast milk exclusively. At 6 months, starting to introduce a variety of solid foods from those 6 groups we looked at, and continuing with breast milk, if possible, at least for the first year and longer if desired, and if not possible, then an iron-fortified formula. Let me know if you're interested in nutrition specifically for kids. This year, I want to invite specialists on to talk about different topics, including some pediatricians, so stay tuned for that. And to wrap things up, here are my predictions, what I think will change in the next version of the guidelines. For the first time ever, we'll see environmental impact of foods considered. They ignored it this year, but I mean, this is a no-brainer. There are no healthy humans on a destroyed planet. We'll also see an increased emphasis on plant sources of protein. I mean, we're already seeing it in some of the wording, and this is only going to increase with time to reflect both the health data and the environmental science. The recommendations won't be plant exclusive or anything like that, but more and more plant centered. And dairy will finally lose some emphasis and be presented as an option, not a necessity. Will I get everything right? Will I nail it? Is it going to be a huge miss? We'll find out. In the meantime, if you want to get a head start, here are my top 7 sources of plant protein and some good alternatives for calcium. Let me know your thoughts. Take care. See you next time.